Hello, this is Matthew Robert Payne, and this is going to be an interview with Lazarus, Jesus' friend. I have a hard time saying Lazarus. I'm not sure if I'm the only one in the world. So I'm just sitting here. I'm freshly shaven. I think I cut myself a couple of times. You may be able to see a bit of blood. It's interesting that I've got a bit of blood on camera. But I'm just here with Lazarus. Many times when the saints come down, I just interview the saints and then I leave it. I don't actually get to spend a lot of time with the saints and talk to them. I seem to finish the interviews and then pack up and upload it and then go from there. And I seem to not to really interact with the saints. So I just want to let you know that that this is enjoyable for me. I enjoy listening to them, but to get full appreciation of the answers and what they said, I really need to re-listen to what was said from each interview to get the full import from what has been said by each of them, because they speak through me, and I do hear what comes out of my mouth, but what's coming out of my mouth isn't formulated by me. They speak to me, and I've got to get an English word and English words for them, and they say things. Some of the things they say I mightn't fully understand before they say it, and so it's interesting for me too. I'm not an expert, and I certainly, since my friend Julie has been formulating the questions, I certainly haven't been able to make up the answers. I've needed the saints to come here and physically sit here and give me the answers to the questions, because many of the answers only the saints would know or Jesus would know. And so I hope that that gives you a little bit of understanding and opens it up a little bit for you in the encouragement. So welcome, Lazarus. I'm happy to say that Mary and Martha are here too, and they're sitting holding hands with Lazarus, and he's happy to be here, and that's good. And I wish that you could see them over on my couch waving. Okay, so question one, Lazarus, can you please tell us about your life, what you were doing before your death, and what caused your death? Lazarus is speaking now. I was a person who owned property and land, and I was a bit of a farmer, and that's what I was doing with my life. I was fortunate to know Jesus, and Jesus was a part of my life, and he often stopped in and visited me on his way in and out of Jerusalem, and we were very close. So I got a real severe strain of pneumonia. I had a problem saying the word. I got a severe case of pneumonia, and I wasn't going to recover. And that's when they sent out the warnings to Jesus. It's not very often hospitals can sort of treat that these days, but back then it was a lot more serious, and there was complications, and my organs shut down. So that's question one. That's what I died of. Nothing that modern medicine can't handle, but certainly back then it was hard. And so I didn't die of cancer or anything like that. Question two, Lazarus, when you were dead for 4 days in the tomb, where was your spirit? Everyone who died, who was a believer in Jesus, a believer or a proper follower of the law and in God's good graces, went to paradise. And Jesus told the parable of the rich man and apparently Lazarus, being a poor man, going to paradise, and he was in Abraham's bosom, and that was a place under the earth that was separated between Hades and paradise, was separated by a chasm, and you couldn't get in between each of the places. But the people who had no chance went to Hades, and the people who had a chance of going to heaven one day went to paradise. So I was in paradise, and I was quite happy there. And then I heard come forth in the tomb, and I came forth. So that's where I spent it. It's interesting. Matthew heard a preacher, and I'll share it here, as the Jews had a belief that that a person could be raised from the dead up until the third day. Their spirits hovered around their body, but on the fourth day, the Jews believed that the spirit departed the body, and it was impossible to be raised from the dead. So Jesus actually delayed his coming to me to make sure it was on the fourth day that the Jewish law, the Jewish understanding said it was impossible to come back from the dead. And so Jesus made sure he was delayed to the fourth day to create a mighty sign and wonder to the Jewish faith that, hey, here's something that you've never seen before. So there was a reason for the 4 days, and it wasn't just 2 days or 3 days, and that was the reason for it to be a great sign. Question three, what was your thinking just before you died? Were you believing Jesus to come and heal you, or did you believe even if you died, he'd raise you up? I loved Jesus. Jesus was his own man. I felt fortunate that he popped in and saw me from time to time when he was in ministry. I saw him in his earlier years, but in times when he was ministering, he used to pop in and use our house as like a respite, a place to rest and relax. And Martha and Mary would wait on him and serve him food, and he'd just relax and pray and talk to his disciples and spend time with us, and he'd just let his hair down. Our place was a place of relaxation. So I knew that Jesus was busy, you know, and there, if he could have come to see me, if that was possible, that he would have come. What I didn't know was that he was going to do that sign and the wonder, and I had to die to cause the Jewish leaders to and some of the Pharisees to believe in Jesus when he raised me from the dead, and it says that in scripture. So I had to die, and in the state of my mind, I was so sick, and I accepted my death, and I knew that Jesus could raise me, but I wasn't expecting him to. You know, it's just like if you grew up with a famous preacher, and he went to your church, and whenever he came back into your city, he came to your church and went out for coffee with you and went out for dinner with you and spent time with you whenever he was in town. And he's an international preacher, and he traveled all over the place, but whenever he was in your city on a day that your church was on, he'd come to your church and he'd go out with you for coffee and go out with you for a meal. You feel really special, and if that was someone in your life, you'd feel really special that he spent time with you. And that's how I felt about Jesus. I had no demands on his time, and we just lived to give him respite and to give him a relaxing time. Jesus found it hard to relax. I'll tell you that about Jesus. He was always about his Father's business. So even when he was relaxing, he was intoxicating to listen to. And he would just be sharing stories of what he's doing in ministry, and story after story. But interwoven amongst the story was a theme and a teaching, and he was always teaching things. And that's why Mary was so fascinated to sit at his feet, because she was just fascinated by his teaching. So so I had no idea that he was going to raise me from the dead, and that would be a funny feeling, knowing that you're dying but you're going to be risen from the dead again. But I had no, until I heard my name getting called forth from the tomb, I had no idea I was going to be healed and rose from the dead. Question four, they say you never smiled. Question four, Matthew just lost his place. They say you never smiled again after Jesus resurrected you. Can you tell us why? First of all, first of all, I was a good friend of Jesus. I was one of his best friends. And while ever Jesus was alive, there was a reason to smile. So some people write history and some people make comments, and they're not well informed. Matthew himself isn't sure where Julie got this information, but it must have come out of a commentary or something. Matthew assumes, I'm not telling Matthew obviously where Julie got this information for a question, but people are allowed to be wrong when they write history. It doesn't have to be right. So I certainly was joyful that I was alive again. It's certainly wonderful to see my sisters again, and see the impact that the early church made on Jewish society. That was exciting times to live, and I lived for another 15 years, 15 to 20 years after I was raised from the dead. So I lived quite old, and I lived to see and experience times with some of the disciples as they used to stop in and see me and my family. So, so it's not true that I didn't smile. I witnessed the birthing of the early church, the greatest time in history, and so I had plenty of reason to be full of joy, and I knew some of the insiders really well. You know, I knew Jesus' inner circle of disciples really well, Where could you come up with the fact that I never smiled again? That means that would sort of hint at the fact that I was upset that I was raised from the dead. I was upset that I was alive, and so it's a good question, but certainly glad to come forth today and put that theory and that accusation to rest. Question five, Lazarus, what did you do after Jesus left, after raising you from the dead, and went to the wilderness called Ephraim? He went there because the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees sought to kill him, even spoke of killing you, because it was the event, Jesus raising you from the dead, that made many Jews believe in Jesus. I went back to my farming life. I had things to do and work to do, and there's works around property that really need a man. And even when you have servants, it's good to have a man in charge. Men respond to women when they're the boss and they're in charge, but men like to respond to men. And so I got up and got back to work, and Jesus was fine. He did tell us that he wasn't going to meet a great end, and we understood that. His disciples didn't seem to want to accept that. Sometimes People wonder how his disciples didn't understand that he was going to die, but you have to understand that their whole lives were invested in Jesus, and they saw a future for themselves in Jesus' ministry. And if Jesus became a ruler and a Messiah and a ruler over the nation and dispelled the Romans, they were going to have positions of importance and ruling importance. So sometimes we don't hear things that we really should have heard. And I was just Jesus' friend. I was a mate of Jesus, to use an Australian term. I was a good friend of Jesus. I had no vested interest in Jesus living and becoming the ruler over this part of the world that we lived in. And so when Jesus confessed to me that he's going to die too, and raising me from the dead was really the nail that was going to go in his coffin and signify his death, I was able to receive it, and so I knew that that was going to happen. But he promised me his Holy Spirit would come, and he promised that he'd visit in visions, and he promised that that I'd see the early church start to arise, and I'd see the glory that he would bring his Father with his resurrection and his ascension to heaven and the coming of the Holy Spirit. So we witnessed all of that, and it was very exciting to see. Question 6, what were your very first thoughts after being raised from the dead? I was so happy to see Jesus. I was so happy to know that there was a place that we could go. I was happy that I'd been accepted in paradise, and that they were awaiting Jesus. And it really was a paradise. It was like a paradise. It was a beautiful place, just like heaven is. And it was had trees, and it was a beautiful place. So I came back from that to living again, and with the promise that I was going to see Jesus' church grow. And so I was really happy. The very first thoughts was happiness in seeing Jesus. And part of you wonders whether you got a memory. Was it all just, did I just wake up and I wasn't, I didn't die at all? Did I just end up in this tomb, and was I just sleeping? But you do remember what happened to you, and just like people who have near-death experiences, they remember going to hell or going to a bright light or going to heaven, and there's plenty of books on that, that not all of them are Christian, but people have memories and encounters, and I certainly remembered paradise and where I'd been. I was very happy to see my sisters because they were heartbroken that I was dead, and that was so overcome. I was spending half my time consoling my sisters because they were just weeping and weeping that I was back. Happy with joy, but overcome with sadness that they'd lost me and now I was back. And it was sadness and tears of joy that I was back. And we went back and took off my grave clothes, and I had a bath and freshened up, and we had a good meal. And we'd certainly created a stir. As I said, a body was said to be finished, and the spirit was finished after 3 days, and on the fourth day it was impossible to be raised. And I did something that was impossible. I come back from the dead after 4 days. You notice Jesus come back from the dead after 3 days, so he didn't do the impossible according to the Jewish. He fit into the Jewish scheme of things, but Jesus didn't appear in public either when he came back. He only appeared to his believers. So he didn't come out publicly and appear in the city for everyone to see him. He only appeared to people who'd already believed in him. And so that's part of the reason People still doubt that Jesus rose from the dead because he didn't appear in public to the great historians in the day. They couldn't record that Jesus had been seen in public because he hadn't been seen in public. He'd only been seen by his believers. And Jesus chose that way so we could truly believe in him, that he truly is the answer. And anyone who does believe in Jesus won't be disappointed and let down by Jesus. Question 7, why did Jesus weep before he raised you from the dead? Do you know, you might be going through a hard time, and you may go through like weeks and weeks of a hard time, and then you come across someone who's really close to you, and you just break down in tears and you start to cry. That's how Jesus was to my sister Mary. Martha asked him, why weren't you here? If you were here, my brother wouldn't have died. And he held his composure, but when Mary came out and asked him the same question and she began to cry, he cried too, because she was so close to him that she brought the tears out in Jesus. And even though he knew he was going to raise me from the dead, he cried for her tears. How you guys go to movies and the actor on the screen is in an emotional scene and he starts to cry and everyone in the cinema starts to open up and start to cry too. He's just an actor. He's just playing a scene in the movie. And you know, an hour before he cried in the movie, you didn't even know who he was. And he's just this fictional character in a movie, but suddenly you're so engaged, they've built you into relationship with the person over an hour, so that when he cries, you cry. Well, Mary was very close to Jesus, and when she pleaded with Jesus, why weren't you here? You could have saved him. And she started to cry. Jesus wept too. So he didn't weep because he was sad, although he was sad that he'd lost me, and the grief of the actual situation that the Father placed him in. Jesus only did what his Father required of him, you know. All of Jesus, as soon as he heard that I was sick, all of Jesus would have wanted to come and raise me up. But it was his Father's will for him to delay to the fourth day and for me to die. Jesus was so submitted to his Father. If Jesus was going to disobey his Father at one time, this is one of the instances where he would have done it. Because he would have come and raised me from the dead if he had his way. If Jesus lived any way in the flesh, if Jesus responded to his flesh in any way, he would have come and raised me from sickness, and I wouldn't have died. But Jesus was 100% submitted to his Father's will. And he even delayed coming to see us because his Father had said that. Now, I don't know who you are, if you're watching this video or reading this book, but there's this common misconception that life with Jesus is easy, that living the Christian life is an easy way to go. I can tell you that Jesus said, unless a man denies himself, takes up his cross and follows me, he's not worthy of me. If a man wants to follow me, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. Jesus said, if a man doesn't hate his mother, father, sisters and brothers, in comparison to me, he's not worthy of me. Jesus said, if you're not prepared to leave your father, mother, sisters, brothers, lands and possession for my sake, you're not worthy of me. There comes a cost in the Christian life. You can only get a certain way into intimacy and the presence of God and the glory of God and the power, signs and wonders of God, you can only get a certain way when you're not obeying. The Christian life is about obeying the Holy Spirit and being led and ruled by the Holy Spirit. So when the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit or his father, told him to delay coming to see me, that's what he did. Jesus didn't have it easy. Jesus didn't have an easy life. And some people assume that Jesus really did have an easy life. Some people think that he didn't have mockers, that there weren't Pharisees crying out for him to be killed. There weren't people mocking him and saying, "You think you're the Son of God? Well, do this." Jesus didn't have an easy life. From sun up to sun down, people mobbed him and flocked to him to be healed. He never seemed to have a spare minute to himself. That's why our house was so important to him as a place where he could just get away and relax. But he never really relaxed. He was with us, but he was always ministering and doing something. He really sewed into people's lives when he just had time to sit his hair down. Even the way he ate, even the way he interacted as he ate, he'd ask you a question before pulling off a piece of bread and chewing it, giving you the time to try and formulate the answer to his question. Like a good rabbi, he asked questions, and he'd ask you a question and pull off a bit of bread and then have olive and eat a couple of olives and chew a bit of bread, and he'd be waiting, and you'd be like waiting for him to speak some more because you didn't have the answer to his question. He'd just keep on eating until you actually tried to answer his question. He was amazing. He was amazing. And he pushed you. And Peter, I think it's come out in interviews before, Peter was always the first to try and answer questions. And Jesus would ask you a question, like he asked me, Lazarus, a question, and you could see Peter wanting to answer. But Jesus would hold up his hand and he'd say, "Come on, answer me, Lazarus." And he'd push me, like a good friend will push their friends. And I wasn't that smart, but I knew his heart. Me and Jesus connected heart to heart. He was my friend, and I loved him dearly. And it really made me cry when he was crucified. Even though I knew what was going to happen, what they did to that man, he wasn't recognizable. It says in Isaiah that he was beaten beyond human recognition. People have got no idea what they did to my Savior. People have got no idea. His face was about 3 foot wide. It was so swollen. People like Passion of the Christ can't display what they did to Jesus because people wouldn't sit through a film and watch it. They could do it with special effects these days. They can do anything, but people wouldn't be able to sit through a film and watch that happen. It really broke my heart when he died. I knew he was going to come back from the dead, but what they did to him. If people only realized what Jesus willingly went through. If people could only understand what he did for everybody. And who are we? Who are we as Christians holding this precious revelation, this precious promise, this precious gift that we've been saved, that we as Christians, you as Christians, have been saved. And you look down your nose at other people who aren't saved, who don't know about this wonderful Jesus and what he went through. We look down our nose at people who aren't saved, like the Jews used to look down their nose at everyone who wasn't a Jew. They treated Gentiles as a second class of human being. And the Christian church, sadly, has become a lot of the same. They look at Muslims and Buddhists and Hindus as another class of people. Jesus died for everybody. He died for everybody. He didn't waste that just for the Christians. You need to let people know that Jesus loves them. And you need to be that love. When they need a handout, give them a handout. When they need a hug, give them a hug. And trust the Holy Spirit to bring them into right relationship with Jesus. Pray for their salvation. And until they ask you questions, just love on them. People respond to love. They want to know. First of all, they want to know what's the catch. When they prove that there's no catch, they want to know what you've got. Question 8. Lazarus, you're one of the few friends Jesus mentioned in Scripture. In fact, Scripture says Jesus loved you. Can you tell us about your friendship with Jesus? I've covered a lot of that, but Jesus was really smart. He was amazing. He could say the most complex thing, and he could say it so simply that I could understand. He explained the kingdom of God to me, but he didn't explain it in parables. He just explained it. I didn't have to think. It was just revelation that he gave me. Of course I was excited when I rose from the dead. I was going to see this kingdom manifest on earth. I lived to see the Pauls and the Peters and people doing miracles and traveling around the known world at the time, setting the world on fire with the gospel. Jesus was very smart. He was led by the Holy Spirit. Everything he did and everything he said came direct from the throne room. Can you imagine meeting a person like that? Can you imagine knowing a person like that? Where everything they did came from God. There wasn't one part of flesh in them. That'd be the sort of person who would finish a conversation before he started a meal. Or carry on a conversation with a person and instead of dismissing them, invite them to come and have a meal with him because it was time for his disciples to eat. And so he'd just invite a leper to our table and say to Mary, make a place for him. He wasn't afraid. He had no fear. Oh, yeah, in the garden he had fear. He had fear because that's where the Spirit of God was starting to leave him. He was shut down, and actually in Scripture, there's one place where he showed his flesh. But he did submit to his Father. But it's the one place in Scripture where you can actually see him have doubts. But he had no fear. He had no worry. He didn't worry. Can you imagine meeting a person who didn't worry and didn't fear? How would your life be? Listener, person listening to this or reading the book in the future, how would your life be if you never feared again and you never worried again? How would you face the coming 30 or 40 years coming to earth and the darkness that's coming to earth? How would you face that time with no fear and no worry? I mean, if you could take fear and worry out of the equation in the Christian life, things would be really sweet, wouldn't they? Well, Jesus never feared until the garden and never worried. People were always coming to him for money, and he always had enough money to give them. Jesus never turned anyone away financially, ever, ever. He never turned anyone away. He's a whole lot different to how the average Christian treats homeless beggars on the street these days. He was a whole lot different. He always had enough. And he didn't go around asking people or charging to speak. People just flocked to him and gave him money. People gave him sheep. People gave him vegetables. People gave him food. People gave blankets. They gave whatever they could give to him, and he used it. He'd kill a sheep and cook it up as a barbecue and put a barbecue on for a whole lot of people and teach them right through the night and would have a roast. He was amazing and he still is amazing. See, that's the beauty of being a Christian. You can get to know Jesus, you can talk to him, he can come and visit you in your house. You can interview Jesus, send a video to Matthew, and then you can tell us all the answers to questions that you've asked Jesus. He's real, but he was amazing. He was a wonderful friend. He used to tell me things that he didn't tell other people. For one instance that I've already told you, he explained the kingdom of God to me, but he didn't use parables. He didn't use complex things that were hard to understand. He explained it simply to me, because I was a simple person. When he's addressing Pharisees, he could quote all the scriptures to back up all his arguments. He could enter into debates with Pharisees and win every part because every question they asked him was answered by the Holy Spirit with the right scripture to back up what was being said. He could have this tremendously intellectual conversation, something that I overheard but I didn't understand. And then he could speak to me simply, face to face, together, and explain just what went on with the Pharisees and what they were trying to prove he was wrong and how he answered them. And he could explain it in layman's terms to me, what just went on and what they were thinking and what were they trying to trap him in, certain traps that they had. He was forgiving. A person really could slap him on the face, and he'd ask him if they need to slap him again. I've seen him do that. People that had spirits of witchcraft and divining spirits, when they were set free and delivered, their masters weren't happy. Jesus was slapped. Jesus knew about turning the other cheek because he did it. There are people in the world that would slap Jesus. We know And his crucifixion, they ripped his beard out and spat on him and slapped him. But his crucifixion wasn't the first time he got spat on or slapped. Jesus didn't come to earth to share a gospel, to share commands and a way of living with people that was impossible. Jesus came with the answer. There's a search you can do on Google, the 50 commands of Jesus Christ, and you can look it up. And you can see the things that Jesus taught us to do. That's the right way to live. It says in John 14:21, if you love Jesus, you'll obey his commands, and the Father will love you, and Jesus will manifest himself to you. You want to see Jesus? Get to know his commands and start to walk in them. You'll see Jesus. He'll want to meet you. He'll want to show himself to you. Matthew's met him so many times in visions. It's so easy for me to sit here with my sisters and speak through Matthew. Matthew's had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours of conversations with Jesus. Sitting here for him, hearing me speak and speaking through me, is really easy for him. It takes a lot of faith to do it, to cop the ridicule and the flack that he gets. But it's really easy. And he knows the spirit of the Lord. And he knows what a wrong spirit is. And it's really easy for him because he's practiced the presence of Jesus. He's practiced speaking to Jesus. He understands Jesus. So he understands us. Because all we've got to say is, Jesus is amazing. You should get to know him. A lot of you people are watching this video don't know him. Like, what's his favorite curry? If you took him out to Thai, what Thai curry would he order? If you took him out to a barbecue, what would he like in his barbecue food? If you took him a selection of 5 different desserts, which dessert would he pick? Do you know those answers? What's his favorite color? You confess Jesus, you know Jesus, you go to church every week. What is Jesus' favorite color? Have you ever asked him? Do you know that? Do you? Matthew does. He asked him. Jesus has things he loves. He loves to talk. Christian church has gone really funny. All they do in prayer is talk, talk, talk. There's 101 books on how to pray. There's not many books on how to listen. Jesus is really amazing to listen. You think I'm interesting to listen to? Jesus is really amazing to listen to. He loves to talk. He loves to answer questions. He loves to be pushed. He loves you to argue with him and say he's wrong. He loves to prove that you're wrong. He doesn't get upset when you argue with him, when you say he's wrong. That proves you've got character. Proves you just don't accept everything you're told. He loves to be challenged. He loves you to challenge yourself. He loves you. That every word out of my mouth is coming from his Holy Spirit. Every word out of Matthew's mouth coming from a word out of my mouth is coming from words the Holy Spirit's told me to tell you. I've got my personality, I've got my character, I've got my assignment, I'm really speaking. But nothing that's being said isn't being ordained by God himself. Jesus loves you so much. He wants to come down and speak to you in language, in a way that you can understand. This is just like Jesus. This is just like Jesus, complete with Matthew wiping his nose and wiping his eyes from crying, complete with scratching nose and getting itchy nose, and complete with all the laughter and the character that Matthew is. All of that's involved in the message. But we want you to know Jesus is real. You can possess him. You can be possessed by him. Jesus can possess you. He can take over your body. We've all heard of demonic possession. We've all heard of people being controlled by lust and demons and anger and violence and murder. What about being possessed by the Holy Spirit? Totally taken by the Holy Spirit. Everything you say and do comes from the Holy Spirit. Wouldn't you just be like Jesus? Wouldn't you just be like Jesus if that happened to you? Wouldn't that be amazing? I got Matthew looking up a scripture at the moment, because it fits with what we say. John 1:2-5, but whoever keeps his word, Jesus' word, but whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself to walk just as he walked. How do you like that scripture? He who says that he abides in Jesus must walk just like Jesus walks. You didn't even know that was in the Bible. That says everything you do and say can be led by the Holy Spirit, and you can walk and talk and react and live just like Jesus lived. But not many people know that scripture in the Bible, and Matthew has never heard a preacher preach on it, because that would totally blow away our excuses that we're just sinners saved by grace. That would just totally blow away the world's perception that you can't be perfect. But you can be. And Jesus is here to help you. And he loves you. And I love Jesus. I love him so much. I hope that you got some insight into my friend there. And I hope I've sufficiently answered that question for you. Question 9. Will you tell us about your two sisters, Mary and Martha, and what they meant to you? Well, there isn't very much said about Mary and Martha. Essentially, we've got the story that Mary anointed Jesus' feet and head with oil, and they said of her that if this perfume was sold, it could have brought a lot of money for the poor. We've got that story, and we've got the famous Mary and Martha story of Mary sitting at Jesus' feet and Martha busy in the kitchen, and Martha coming out to complain to Mary, saying, there's a lot of work to be done. Can't you tell my sister to come and help me? And Jesus saying lovingly to Martha, because he knew her, Mary's chosen the better thing. Do you know, I'll tell you one thing. When you're in the anointing, when the presence of God is thick on you, you lose your appetite. Jesus could speak for 12 hours straight and not have to have a drink and not have to eat. We know this it's hinted at one time when Jesus was with the Samaritan woman getting some water. He asked for a drink. His disciples come back from town with the food and offered him some. He says, I'm already full. And they said, where did you get your food? And he says, I've got food that the Father gives me that you don't know of. That's the anointing. The anointing satisfies you. So when Jesus was in the anointing, he didn't have to eat or drink. And anyone who sits under his teaching, who has the anointing come on them, doesn't have to eat or drink over. You can be so full of Jesus that you don't have to eat. So Mary was quite happy to wait for another 3 hours until Jesus had spoke before she got up and prepared the food. They didn't have to eat. And Mary saw no compulsion to get up and prepare the food. The food she was receiving was sustaining her enough. Now, people run from conference to conference and book to book and sermon to sermon on YouTube, searching for spiritual nourishment, searching for food. But when the anointing rests on your life, you can pick up the Bible and one paragraph can blow you away and keep your mind active for a week or months. Matthew meditated Psalm 1, the first three verses, for 8 years. He was meditating on the scripture for 8 years. Three verses of scripture. Mary loved Jesus. Martha loved him too. But Martha was just not as connected to Jesus as Mary was initially. Martha learned, you know, there's a story in Mary and Martha for everyone. So many people in ministry, Matthew's heard from a good teacher, so many people in ministry, they start out at the feet of Jesus, soaking, spending time in his presence, reading his word, meditating and praying. And they spend a lot of time with Jesus. And what happens is revival breaks out, or a real move of God breaks out in their church. Then they start getting invitations to other churches and getting busy with meetings. They initially started off as a Mary at Jesus' feet. But then they turn into a Martha getting busy doing ministry. And they don't get back to that secret place with the Lord. So everyone swings between a Mary and a Martha. Mary sometimes wonder if they could do more. So some people have learnt to rest, have learnt to spend time at the feet of Jesus, but then they get worried that they're not doing enough. Some people can't be happy unless they're doing something. And yet, there's a happy balance where you can minister out of rest. That you can be very busy, but be in a restful, blissful state and always spending time with the Lord and having a lot of time with the Lord. For instance, Heidi Baker can spend up to 5 hours in prayer each morning before she comes out and does ministry. She's got a very busy ministry with 10,000 churches and 10,000 orphans. She's a very busy woman. Anyone thinks that they could find less time with Jesus, but sometimes she spends up to 5 hours in a day before she even starts doing what she did. Jesus was the same with his Father. Often you'd spend the whole night up. Another thing when you're anointed is you don't need sleep. So Jesus could go days at a time where he could minister all day and stay up with his Father all night. And he could go days like that. Some saints have been recorded not to go to sleep for weeks and months. Some saints in history have been recorded not to have eaten for a year. These things are possible with the supernatural. So Mary was a lover. And Martha came along too. After Jesus showed her what was best, she relaxed. Mary was able to say, "I'll help you," when Jesus finished speaking. Martha was able to relax and not get about the preparation of dinner and spend time with Jesus before she got the dinner ready. I loved Martha. We all need Marthas in our life. Things just don't get done without someone who's practical. But oh, we need some worship leaders that are Marys. We need some pastors that are Marys. We need some prophets that are Marys. We need Marthas to get things done. We need Marys to get things done. We need a combination of both. We need someone who's practical, who spends time with the Lord. See, Jesus was both. Jesus was busy all day and restful or not, but he was even resting while he was ministering. Everything that came to Jesus was devised by the Father and planned by the Father. Jesus used to see his whole day of ministry as he was in prayer at night. He'd see the upcoming day and the miracles. It was no wonder that he healed a certain boy that couldn't be healed by his disciples, because he'd seen the boy come. He'd heard the conversation from the Father before the Father even presented himself. You need to be a Mary and a Martha. But there's a great fallacy by the Marthas in this world, that if the world was full of Marys, nothing would get done. Then there's a great fallacy with people that want to spend time with the Lord and just soak in his presence. A lot of them can be lazy people and not actually doing things. God doesn't want you spending all day at his feet for you not to reproduce and not to have fruit. The Bible calls us to have fruit. So there's a good combination of both that's needed. Mary was a big lover. My sister was a big lover. She really treasured Jesus. Like, Matthew really enjoys doing this interview because he really loves to hear me speak, but it's five times as better hearing Jesus. He's just like a port, drinking a port wine. Just the beautiful taste of port. Matthew really likes port. I'm not aware that all of you might not like port, but we gave him that word and then told him to talk about it, and so he is talking about it. But if you don't like port, well, it might mean as much to you. But Jesus was a fine liqueur, and he's just amazing to listen to. Matthew's heard him preach through Matthew for 2 hours once, and he'd stop for 5 seconds and Matthew would panic. It was just amazing. People used to listen all day and all night to him. I mean, Paul preached for 18 hours in one go, one time. So don't you think Jesus would have done it? He was amazing. He is amazing. You should hear him speak. A whole lot of Christians, you know, Matthew should write a book. Why don't you stop praying and start listening? That would be a good book. Yeah, that sounds like a good book. I think I could write a few pages on that, Matthew says. Yeah, why don't you stop praying and start listening? Yeah, wouldn't it would even pay to listen to the commands of Jesus once again? Read them and listen and do, you know, like Mary says, do what he tells you to do. Anyway, so Mary was a lover. That's why when she cried and said, Jesus, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died, it brought tears to Jesus' face. Mary stars in films in heaven. She's a great little actress. She's a great worshiper. She sings songs in heaven. And Martha, she's just a delight. And I'm caught because I love both my sisters. Martha was so practical. If you wanted an editor for your book, Martha was perfect. Martha would be perfect to edit. She just sees everything. She's down the line, very ordered, very structured. She just gets things done. If you need a general manager, you need someone to look after your whole business and run your whole show. You just put Martha in charge. She'll just get it done. And she only have people around her that are movers and shakers. You know, you get Mary and Martha. Mary would be the Benny Hinn, the worship leader speaker, and Martha would be her general manager that put the show on the road for you. If you don't know who Benny Hinn is, he's just a large evangelist that goes from stadium to stadium. He needs someone in charge of all the logistics. Well, Martha would be your logistics person. Benny Hinn wouldn't have just anyone being a logistics person. They wouldn't just be good at doing that. They'd have a very deep relationship with Jesus, and Martha did have that eventually. So I loved both my sisters, and it was great to come back from the dead and spend more time with them until I died. Question 10. When your time came the second time, did you die and get buried, or were you taken up? The scriptures don't tell us this. There's a scripture in the Bible that says this. It's appointed once for man to die, and then comes the judgment. A lot of people think really holy people don't die, they get taken up. But for that scripture to be true, people have to die. And people who got taken up need to die too. Because if they didn't die, that scripture wouldn't prove true. So people believe that Mary, Jesus' mother, didn't die, she ascended. People believe certain saints, like John, the disciple, didn't die. They have all these assumptions about people that didn't die. So, how is that scripture? It's appointed once for man to die, then comes the judgment. How would that scripture work if people weren't dying? So, I died. Okay, that's a quick and easy answer to your question. I hope that this has been encouraging to you. Once again, Matthew sees that it's different interview. He really enjoyed having me speak, and I really enjoyed speaking. One of the best things you can do is get a video like this and share it on your Facebook and say, this may seem way out there, but I'm a Christian and this really spoke to me. Now, don't post negative comments if you can hold back. But I just heard Lazarus speak from the grave. He came down from heaven and he spoke in a video, and here's the video. I'm sharing it with you, my friends, so that you can hear it too. And hopefully some of your non-Christian friends would listen to this video. I really believe that this would impact them. Certainly would recommend staying in touch with Matthew Robert Payne and getting the book when this book is made into a transcript. Heaven is aware of where this book will go. Heaven is aware where this interview will go and what hearts need to be touched. But this is certainly a video you need to share on your Facebook. God bless.